think we have time to go to another sutta. Sutta number 14, Majjhima Nikaya. Chula Dukkha Kanda Sutta, the shorter discourse on the merits of suffering. Thus have I heard. On one occasion, the Blessed One was living in the Sakyan country at Kapilavatu in Igroda's farm. Then Mahanama, the Sakyan, went to the Blessed One, and after paying homage to him, he sat down at one side and said, "Venerable Sir, I have long understood the Dhamma taught by the Blessed One thus. Greed is an imperfection that defiles the mind. Hatred is an imperfection that defiles the mind. Delusion is an imperfection that defiles the mind. Yet while I understand the Dhamma taught by the Blessed One thus, at times states of greed, hatred and delusion invade my mind and remain. I have wondered, Venerable Sir, what state is still unabandoned by me internally, owing to which at times these states of greed, hatred and delusion invade my mind and remain." Stop here for a moment. This Mahanama is a relative of the Buddha, I think something like his cousin or something, and a Sakyan. So one day when the Buddha was in his hometown, I think, of Kapilavatu, and Mahanama came and asked him, said that he has long understood the Dhamma, understood that greed, hatred and delusion are defilements. And yet sometimes this greed, hatred and delusion invade the mind and remain. So he's wondering what has not been abandoned by him yet. Then the Buddha said, "Mahanama, there is still a state unabandoned by you internally, owing to which at times states of greed, hatred and delusion invade your mind and remain. For were that state already abandoned by you internally, you would not be living the home life. You would not be enjoying sensual pleasures. It is because that state is unabandoned by you internally that you are living the home life and enjoying sensual pleasures. Even though a noble disciple has seen clearly as it actually is with proper wisdom how sensual pleasures provide little gratification, much suffering and much despair, and how great is the danger in them. As long as he still does not attain to the delight and pleasure that are apart from sensual pleasures, apart from unwholesome states, or to something more peaceful than that, he may still be attracted to sensual pleasures. But when a noble disciple has seen clearly as it actually is, with proper wisdom, how sensual pleasures provide little gratification, much suffering and much despair, and how great is the danger in them, and he attains to the delight and pleasure that are apart from sensual pleasures, apart from unwholesome states, or to something more peaceful than that, then he is no longer attracted to sensual pleasures." Let's stop here for a moment. These few words by the Buddha are very important. The Buddha told Mahanama that even an Aryan disciple, he has the wisdom to see that sensual pleasures are very dangerous and the source of much suffering. Yet he may still be attracted to sensual pleasures unless he can attain the delight and pleasure, piti and sukha, apart from sensual pleasures, apart from unwholesome states. This refers to the first jhana. When a person attains the first jhana, he attains piti and sukha, which are apart from sensual pleasures and apart from unwholesome states. And or to something more peaceful than that refers to the higher jhanas, the second jhana, third jhana onwards, is something more peaceful than that. So only when a person attains to the jhanas, then he is no longer attracted to sensual pleasures, for the simple reason that jhana, the bliss from jhana, is a higher happiness. Just now, the previous sutta, we talked about the gratification of feelings. The higher satisfaction in feelings is when a person abides in jhana. So when you have already tasted the happiness of jhana, then you can let go of human sensual pleasures. It's just like a person has attained the happiness of a heavenly being, and then he has become a heavenly being. He looks down at the world, the human beings, and even though he sees human beings enjoying sensual pleasures and all that, he does not want to come down to enjoy. Why? Because he is enjoying a higher type of happiness in heaven. So in the same way, when a person attains the bliss of jhana, then he's no more attracted to sensual pleasures. So sensual pleasures are coarser type of happiness and not so deep. So here the Buddha is telling Mahanama that if Mahanama had attained that state, he would not be living the home life. In other words, if a person, a lay person, he has attained jhana, then the Buddha implies here that he's not likely to remain a lay person. He's more likely to renounce, become a monk. Because once a lay person has practiced meditation until he attains jhana, then he has the confidence to go forth, because he knows that he will be happier, at least mentally happier, in robes. So nowadays you find some people think that they have attained great states of jhana, but if they cannot let go of the lay life, then from this sutta you would find that it's not very likely that they have attained. The Buddha continued, "Before my enlightenment, while I was still only an unenlightened bodhisattva, I too clearly saw, as it actually is with proper wisdom, how sensual pleasures provide little gratification, much suffering and much despair, and how great is the danger in them. But as long as I still did not attain to the delight and pleasure that are apart from sensual pleasures, apart from unwholesome states, or to something more peaceful than that, I recognized that I still could be attracted to sensual pleasures. But when I clearly saw, as it actually is with proper wisdom, how sensual pleasures provide little gratification, much suffering and much despair, and how great is the danger in them. And I attained to the delight and pleasure that are apart from sensual pleasures, apart from unwholesome states, or to something more peaceful than that. I recognized that I was no longer attracted to sensual pleasures. And what is the gratification in the case of sensual pleasures? Mahanama, there are these five causes of sensual pleasure." And then the Buddha describes the gratification of sensual pleasure as described in the previous sutta. And then after that, the Buddha talked about the danger in the case of sensual pleasures. That was already what we went through just now. Now this too is a danger in the case of sensual pleasures, a mess of suffering in the life to come. Having sensual pleasures as its cause, sensual pleasures as its source, sensual pleasures as its basis, the cause simply being sensual pleasures. Now Mahanama, on one occasion I was living at Rajagaha on the mountain Vulture Peak. On that occasion a number of Nigantas or Jains were living on the black rock on the slopes of Isigili and were practicing continuous standing, rejecting seats, and were experiencing painful, racking, piercing feelings due to exertion. Stop here for a moment. These Nigantas are also called Jains. And they are these naked ascetics, one type of naked ascetics. And they like to torture themselves. So in this case, they were standing day and night. And because of standing day and night, they were having a lot of pain. Still, they continue to stand because they think they want to siu yip jiong, get rid of their bad karma, pay off their bad their sins. Then when it was evening, I rose from meditation and went to the Nigantas there. I asked them, "Friends, why do you practice continuous standing, rejecting seats, and experience painful, racking, piercing feelings due to exertion?" When this was said, they replied, "Friend, the Niganta Nataputta is omniscient and all-seeing and claims to have complete knowledge and vision thus." This Niganta Nataputta is their leader, also known as Mahavira. And he claims, "Whether I am walking or standing or asleep or awake, knowledge and vision are continuously, uninterruptedly present to me." So he claims that all the time, 24 hours a day, he has knowledge and vision. The Buddha also dare not claim that. He says thus, "Nigantas, you have done evil actions in the past, exhaust them with the performance of piercing austerities. And when you are here and now restrained in body, speech and mind, that is doing no evil actions for the future. So by annihilating with asceticism past actions and by doing no fresh actions, there will be no consequence in the future. with no consequence in the future, there is the destruction of action, karma. With the destruction of action, there is the destruction of suffering. With the destruction of suffering, there is the destruction of feeling. With the destruction of feeling, all suffering will be exhausted. This is the doctrine we approve of and accept, and we are satisfied with it. When this was said, I told them, but friends, do you know that you existed in the past, and that it is not the case that you did not exist? And they said, no, friend. But friends, do you know that you did evil actions in the past, and did not abstain from them? And they said, no, friend. But friends, do you know that you did such and such evil actions? And they said, no, friend. But friends, do you know that so much suffering has already been exhausted, or that so much suffering has still to be exhausted, or that when so much suffering has been exhausted, all suffering will have been exhausted? And they said, no, friend. But friends, do you know what the abandoning of unwholesome states is, and what the cultivation of wholesome states is here and now? And they said, no, friend. And the Buddha said, so friends, it seems that you do not know that you existed in the past, and that it is not the case that you did not exist, or that you did evil actions in the past and did not abstain from them, or that you did such and such evil actions, or that so much suffering has already been exhausted, or that so much suffering has still to be exhausted, or that when so much suffering has been exhausted, all suffering will have been exhausted, or what the abandoning of unwholesome states is, and what the cultivation of wholesome states is here and now. That being so, those who are murderers, bloody-handed evil-doers in the world, when they are reborn among human beings, go forth into homelessness as Nigantas. I'll stop here for a moment. So the Buddha said that you all claim to exhaust your bad karma, your bad offenses of the past, by torturing yourselves. But the Buddha asked them, do you know that you actually existed in the past? They said they don't know. Do you know that you did evil in the past? They also said they don't know. Do you know you did how much evil? And they said they don't know. Do you know how much evil you have exhausted? They also said don't know. So the Buddha said, since you don't know all these things, you must be previous life, all of you must have been murderers and great criminals. So now all of you have to pay back. That's why you go and torture yourselves as Nigantas. And they said, friend Gotama, pleasure is not to be gained through pleasure. Pleasure is to be gained through pain. For were pleasure to be gained through pleasure, then King Sinya Bimbisara of Magadha would gain pleasure, since he abides in greater pleasure than the venerable Gotama. Stop here for a moment. This is an ordinary wisdom, ordinary worldlings' wisdom. They think that you have to torture yourselves to attain happiness. So you find external ascetics, they do all kinds of austerities, basically to torture themselves. And even nowadays, people still do it. They think it's a little bit more subtle. Like taking vegetarian food is one way of torturing yourself. Another one is like some of these Muslims, they use the whip, they whip themselves. Hindus also, some type of Hindus, they whip themselves, torture themselves. And Christians, many hundreds of years ago also, they used to do that, whip themselves. And sometimes the whips they use will draw blood on that. So this is an ordinary worldling's way of thinking. And then he said, if pleasure is to be gained through pleasure, then the Magadha's King Bimbisara would get greater pleasure since he is now enjoying himself. He's enjoying more pleasure than the Venerable Gotama. And then the Buddha said, surely the Venerable Nigantas have uttered these words rashly and without reflection. Rather, it is I who ought to be asked, who abides in greater pleasure, King Sinya Bimbisara of Magadha or the Venerable Gotama? So here the Buddha told them, you should ask me first, who is happier, the King Bimbisara or the Venerable Gotama is happier. And then they said, surely friend Gotama, we uttered those words rashly and without reflection, but let that be. Now we ask the Venerable Gotama, who abides in greater pleasure, King Sinya Bimbisara of Magadha or the Venerable Gotama? And the Buddha said, then friends, I shall ask you a question in return. Answer it as you like. What do you think, friends? Can King Sinya Bimbisara of Magadha abide without moving his body or uttering a word, experiencing the peak of pleasure or happiness for 7 days and 7 nights? And they said, no, friend. Can King Sinya Bimbisara of Magadha abide without moving his body or uttering a word, experiencing the peak of pleasure for 6, 5, 4, 3, or 2 days and nights, or for 1 day and night? And they said, no, friend, to each of these. But the Buddha said, but friends, I can abide without moving my body or uttering a word, experiencing the peak of pleasure or happiness for 1 day and night, for 2 days, 3, 4, 5, 6 days and nights, for 7 days and nights. What do you think, friends? That being so, who dwells in greater pleasure or happiness, King Bimbisara of Magadha or I? And they said, that being so, the Venerable Gotama abides in greater pleasure than King Sinya Bimbisara of Magadha. That is what the Blessed One said. Mahanama the Sakyan was satisfied and delighted in the Blessed One's words. So here the Buddha says that King Bimbisara, he cannot experience unremitting happiness for a few days. But the Buddha said, I can experience the greatest pleasure for 7 days and 7 nights without moving, without uttering a word. Bliss out like high on drugs like that. But even more higher happiness. So that's the end of the sutta. So this sutta, what is the most interesting part is the beginning where the Buddha says that we can only let go of sensual pleasures in the world when we attain a higher happiness, namely the bliss of jhana. And if a person can attain the bliss of jhana, it is more likely that he would not be living the home life and enjoying sensual pleasures. He would want to renounce and enjoy jhanic pleasures, pleasure, the happiness in deep meditation. I think we stop here and can discuss anything. Yeah, that's what the commentaries say. He may not have, but from this sutta it appears that he does not have. But I think it's not for sure that the commentaries are correct. I would think that Mahanama is more likely to be a Sotapanna than a Sakadagamin, because he sees greed, hatred and delusion invades his mind. Because for the Sakadagamin, the once returner, greed, hatred and delusion is lessened. So he probably is a Sotapanna.
Just now when you talk about the king, when you talk that the people, so between the soldiers and the king has he gave instruction to the soldiers to kill the man. So who of between the two, which one creates the bad karma? Is it the king who has the thought, or the
Buddha says that karma is intention, right? Karma is intention. So when the king gives the order to execute the man, firstly he has the intention to have that man killed, right? But then we must also know what was his state of mind. If he thought that this man has to be killed to protect everybody else, then for him maybe the karma is not so heavy. But if he thinks I'm all powerful, I want him to be killed, in that case his karma could be more. Okay. Then similarly for the executioner, if the executioner thinks, I don't like to kill this man, but then the king orders that I kill him. If I don't kill this man, my head may be chopped off. So he has no choice. He does it a bit unwillingly. Then his karmic offense is not so great. Just like, for example, our mothers used to slaughter the chicken for us to eat. Our mothers, when she slaughters the chicken, she doesn't have the hatred for the chicken. In fact, she pity the chicken. She recite a few verses. May you go to heaven, have a good rebirth and all these things. And then, so the intention is very important. So if the executioner, he does it not so willingly, the karmic offense is not so great. But if he does it with pleasure, then the karmic offense would be very great. Sometimes when the Buddha makes a certain statement, it is a general truth, but there are exceptions. So in the case of those lay disciples who attain jhana and remain as lay disciples, those are exceptions. There are more of them who, after attaining jhana, renounce. Like generally, lay disciples cannot become arahant. Generally, only monks and nuns become arahant. But there are exceptions. Sometimes you have some lay person hearing the Buddha's Dharma, and they attain to arahanthood. But after attaining to arahanthood, they will not remain as lay persons. They would definitely go forth. From what the Buddha said about the cemetery being an unclean place, that the vibes are no good, that it's not the ideal place to meditate. But somebody who is, for example, very serious about meditation and is a bit advanced, he may want to go to the cemetery. But for beginners, not advisable at all for beginners to go to the cemetery, because I know some people who have gone and have been very frightened by some things that happen, because some things do happen. And one lady who was at one time a nun, she was asked by the teacher to go and sit in a particular spot in the cemetery, and she didn't realize that she was sitting over a grave. So in the middle of her meditation at night, something came to disturb her, and she was very frightened from that experience. But luckily, she didn't go out of her mind. If you have a person with a weaker mind, might go out of the mind. So it's not advisable for beginners go to such places, dangerous places. Even for monks, it's not advisable. So what more for beginners and especially lay people?
Because I asked about my meditation, and she said, "This is the time for meditation." But the day you really do that, and he's supposed to meditate on
you're sitting on a grave, it's not necessary that you meditate on the body. You can meditate on anything. In fact, you should meditate on a subject that will give you, that will make your mind concentrated as soon as possible, so that if anything happens, at least your mind is more steady. Okay, shall we end here for tonight?